Welcome, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all. I would like to welcome you to the pre-seminar webinar for the 7th Annual Tourism and Protected Area Seminar. I'm Erin Hicks, the Training Coordinator for the Center for Protected Area Management. Just to go over the agenda for our seminar today, we're going to do a brief introduction of our team, go over the philosophy of the seminar, cover what to expect during the seminar, and just go over some last-minute logistics. Ultimately, we'd like you to write questions in the chat box so that we can respond to your questions at the end of the seminar. My name is Erin. I am the training coordinator. I work on the logistics for the seminar. This is my third year doing this seminar, and very excited to meet every one of you and learn from you. So I'd like to pass it on to my colleague, Ryan.
Hello, I'm Ryan Fincham. I'm the co-director of the seminar as well as of the Center for Protected Area Management. My colleague Jim Barbrack, who's joining us remotely from Costa Rica, is also the co-director of the seminar and of the Center for Protected Area Management. Jim and I both designed this seminar 8 years ago and have been leading the seminar during its first 7 editions. In addition to the three of us that are participating on the call today, we also have Dr. Steve McCool, who's a senior advisor for the seminar. Steve has been very active in tourism and protected area issues around the world, including with IUCN, and will be participating with the seminar during the final portion of the program, which will be in the Greater Yellowstone area, including both Yellowstone National Park and Grand Teton National Park. In addition to Steve, we have both Javier and Damaris, who will be participating with us principally as drivers. Javier is a postdoc, and Damaris is Jim Barbarak's lovely wife. And finally, Kyle Horton will be joining us as a guest from the U.S. Forest Service International Programs Office. The U.S. Forest Service and their International Programs Office in Washington, D.C., is a co-sponsor of this seminar, along with the Center for Protected Area Management at Colorado State University. And they're an important technical partner and an important financial partner that has made possible the participation of many of you in the seminar this year. So we'd like to thank the U.S. Forest Service for all of their support and their collaboration. One thing we just wanted to mention as we start off is just to provide some clarity on the difference between the word seminar and course. At the Center for Protected Area Management, we participate in a wide variety of capacity development activities, including the delivery of seminars, courses, as well as internships, and other formats of capacity development. We just wanted to provide a bit of clarity and differentiation between the word course and seminar. You might hear us occasionally refer to this seminar as a course. However, we have provided the distinction of this being a seminar due to the fact that it tends to be a little less formal than a course. Generally speaking, courses require some formal evaluation, tests or exams that would be delivered throughout the duration of the course to measure your learning and engagement. A seminar, on the other hand, tends to be a bit more informal. And we will have some lectures at the beginning and ends of the seminar, but throughout much of the seminar, we're largely going to be based in the field, visiting sites each and every day, and then providing different opportunities for reflection and discussion among the team. Also, with the case of a seminar, we view the learning platform to be very horizontal. In other words, we view everyone that's here participating to be both teachers and learners. We include ourselves in that category as well. We learn just as much from you all as we may provide through our lectures. So we wanted to invite you all to be part of that seminar experience, to be part of the teaching team, and to really take advantage of the seminar to help inform your own personal learning objectives for being here. And please let us know how we can help you get the most out of this seminar. This is kind of just a photo with a typical example of what a day in the seminar might look like, where we would be out in the field, either meeting with protected area managers, or in this case, meeting with a member of the Lakota tribe in South Dakota, and learning a bit about how the Lakota view their landscape and how they interact with the National Park Service in that part of our country. I've already mentioned this briefly, how we're going to be focusing primarily on getting out into the field and comparing and contrasting, but we will have some initial lectures on key topics towards the beginning and then again towards the end of the seminar. We do think it's very important to make sure that we're all kind of on the same page, as we would say. So we have these leveling courses where we just want to provide some initial background, some initial key concepts or topics that will help us start the conversation around some of the things that we'll be seeing throughout the seminar. So overview on the status of tourism in protected areas around the world, interpretation as a communication tool, basics of protected area planning. Some of those types of topics we'll see towards the beginning. We also have a number of topics that'll come towards the end. Overview presentations on finance and capacity building. So there'll be a handful of key topics that will be present throughout the seminar. But by and large, it's going to be a seminar where we're out in the field each day visiting protected areas, visiting communities, and visiting different tourism offerings that are being provided for in protected areas. At the beginning of the seminar, just as an example, not only will we be giving presentations, but we have already provided you with the PowerPoint format that we're going to be asking that you use when you present your brief presentations at the beginning of the seminar that help enlighten us about the work that each of you are doing. That also helps us incorporate your experiences better into the seminar to understand more about where each of you are coming from, the experiences that you bring, and it also just provides an opportunity for horizontal learning among all of us so that we know the kinds of issues, the kinds of things that you're working on. These intro presentations provide you just a very short window. We know there's always interest in being able to present for 15, 20 minutes about your area, but we've learned over the years that we need to keep the presentations fairly short and succinct. If not, the presentations can take up quite a bit of time. So we're going to ask you to keep on task with those presentations, and as you start to work and prepare them, to make sure you keep them to 9 minutes is what I think we're asking, 9 to 10 minutes. As I mentioned, site visits are used for comparing and contrasting, and I think as you read through the agenda in this week, we'll be sending out the agenda in just a few days, so that you have that and can read through it before you depart for the U.S. I think you're going to see that we've got quite a few very exciting site visits prepared for the seminar. From in Colorado, in Wyoming, in South Dakota, and in Montana. So we're going to be covering a four-state area in the western United States. We think that the areas that we've selected are going to provide a really good opportunity for you all to compare and contrast and open up a whole series of discussions about what's going on and what's working and what's not working. For example, here we are in Yellowstone National Park, engaged in a conversation with our senior advisor, Steve McCool, about the creation of national parks and how they're being managed. One of the interesting things about these seminars, and sometimes people ask, well, why do you host these seminars in the United States? Well, we're not trying by any means to say that the way it's being conducted in the United States is the way that it should be adopted around the world. We would never do that. However, we do think that in the United States, with such a long history dating back to 1872 with the declaration of Yellowstone as one of the first national parks in the world, that it does provide an opportunity to learn from some of the mistakes that we've made, but also to learn from some of the successes. And because we're hosting this seminar in the United States, we also find that it provides opportunity for our participants from around the world to be able to critique openly what they feel is not working, because there's no participants from the United States here that would, perhaps feel uncomfortable with those kinds of conversations. When we host courses in a particular country for people from those countries, sometimes we find that there's a resistance to diving deeper and discussing more openly what's working and what's not working for fear of potential retaliation from agencies or from organizations that may be based locally in that country. And we won't have that situation here in the United States. And so we want to make clear that we will have an opportunity and a platform for open discussion about the positive things we're seeing, but also about the negative things, about the things that you don't think are working. Here's just another photo of some of the landscapes that we'll be seeing in the Black Hills of South Dakota and in Yellowstone National Park. Also on the agenda, you'll see we have lots of visits with different agencies that manage our protected areas, but also with community staff or for organizations or individuals that provide ecotourism or tourism opportunities in protected areas or in the gateway communities outside of them. And we'll also meet with concessionaires in the private sector and learn how they interact with and provide additional support to public use in protected areas. This is, for example, a visit to the Black Hills National Forest, where we'll also be meeting with staff from the U.S. Forest Service. And this is a couple that offers tourism opportunities outside of one of the national forests that we're visiting through an agritourism format, where they basically provide housing, room and board, and then offer horseback riding experiences that include visits into the national forest. And here we are visiting with some of the rangers from Rocky Mountain National Park, which is the closest national protected area to Colorado State University. We also want to make sure that there's time for reflection and discussion. And some of this reflection will happen on an individual basis, because we know that each one of you brings your own interests and your own challenges that you're hoping to inform throughout the program. But we're also going to provide some opportunity for group discussion and reflection. And so periodically throughout the seminar, every few days, we'll try to find an opportunity to sit down as a group and just reflect on the things that we've seen over the previous days and open up a discussion and dialogue about what we've seen. So sometimes it's informal, just pulling up a chair gathered around the outdoors, or sometimes it can be inside a classroom. We're also going to be asking you to do a reflection at the end through the creation of an action plan, where we'll actually ask you to, based on conversations, based on the site visit, based on something you've seen, put together an action plan for a project that you'd like to implement after the seminar. And sometimes those ideas will come about through these kinds of discussions. As you'll notice, the weather can be variable in the United States, in this part of the United States, during September. So we encourage you, if you have some warmer weather clothing, to consider bringing some of that. We have some warmer weather things that we can let you borrow if you come from a tropical country and don't have hats and gloves and things like that. But do note that we will be out and about, and sometimes the only meeting places that we will be able to find will be outdoors. And here we have an example
just
of...
Just to mention that you said for them to bring... You said for them to bring warmer weather clothing. I think you meant colder weather clothing.
Yes, you should bring clothing for cold weather, which is clothing that would provide warmth. Thanks, Jim.
And I already mentioned the idea of preparing the action plan at the end of the seminar. We'll be providing you with more information about that once you arrive in Colorado. And so just to provide you a little more information about the participant presentations that I mentioned earlier, We have, and you'll see this on the agenda once you get it in just a few days. We've organized your presentations onto specific days based on regional groups. We'll be giving you a maximum of 10 minutes per person. We apologize in advance that we will have to keep strict time and make sure you stick to those 10 minutes. The reason why we are so strict in sticking to those 10 minutes is that we feel like if we make everyone stick to those 10 minutes, that we're treating everyone equally. And so if you get to 10 minutes, we will let you know that your time has ended. But of course, we'll be giving you a 2-minute warning, 1-minute warning, and then at 10 minutes, we will ask you to wrap up your presentation so that we can make time for the next participant. And the idea, you know, a lot of times we all come from beautiful places and have amazing biodiversity amazing features that we're protecting through our conservation work. And we hope to get to know that information throughout the seminar about each one of you. Although we just want to mention here that the idea of these overview presentations isn't to spend the full 10 minutes just talking about the biodiversity of your countries. Like I said, that is important. But the idea more for these presentations is we'd like to make sure that within that 10 minutes, we can get to know a little bit more about you, about your work, about your challenges and the opportunities that you see for the development of tourism in your protected area. The biodiversity is critical. The amazing places you're working to protect are also very important. And you can hopefully cover that very briefly in your presentation. But what we've seen in the past is a lot of times people will spend almost 5, 6, 8, 9 minutes of their presentations just talking about the biodiversity or giving us an overview of their country or giving us an overview of their organization. And while all that's important, we don't want you to lose time on telling us the important details about what you do day in and day out in your job. What is it that keeps you up at night? What are you struggling with? What are you succeeding at in your job? Because that will help us really understand those common threads that we have between us and really provide a pathway for deeper discussion and dialogue throughout the seminar. You can, of course, use this opportunity to share a few photos. And it's really meant as an opportunity to start the conversation. This isn't the opportunity that you have to communicate everything. We're going to have lots of days driving in vans across vast landscapes where we're going to have lots of opportunities to talk in more depth about our work. So make sure to keep it short. Just provide an overview and really try to hone in on helping us understand what it is that you do. And we're going to be doing this basically all day September 6th and part of the day September 7th at the beginning of the seminar so that we do have this understanding right from the get-go about what each of you are doing.
And you'll need to submit your presentations on the first day so that we can organize them. So either emailing me the presentations or bringing in a USB. So the presentations should be done by the first day of the seminar.
Each one of you can decide to organize the presentation as you would like. Sometimes people like to focus in on one particular area of their work, whatever particular area is most important or that you're most focused on now. If you work in a bunch of different protected areas, you could choose to just briefly highlight them all and then talk more about what your role is in working across that group of protected areas. Or if you prefer to just focus in on one protected area, that is also a totally fine approach. So we give each of you the leverage to make your own decisions about how you'd like to structure the way you focus on your work. But know that in the end, what we're most interested in is getting to know more about what you do on a day-to-day basis to achieve your goals in tourism and tourism in protected areas.
And so from Colorado, we try really hard to make your arrival to the U.S. as smooth as possible. And the way we do that is through a lot of communication. I thank you in advance for reading all of the emails I've sent you. There's still an email to come that will have some last minute important information. So please read the logistics letter, which is the go-to source for information regarding the course. If you have a question regarding travel dates, what to bring, the weather, etc., I sent you the logistics letter at the very beginning of our communications. I've also sent you some emails, so please review those emails and information in detail. This course is intensive. There's very few opportunities to have free time. This is really taking advantage of the conservation dollars that have been donated from your donors so that you can take advantage of your time in the U.S. and your time with your colleagues, learning from their experiences around the world.
We have in the past tried to lighten the load a little bit, and over the time we've actually reduced the number of hotels that we stay in, where in the first and second versions of the seminar we were changing hotels every night or every two nights. Now we're only changing hotels usually every two to three nights, depending on where we are. So we have lightened the load a little bit. But we have also considered over the years maybe taking out a visit or two to make the seminar a little less intense. And when we've asked people what we should take out, everybody says every single year there's nothing that you can take out because we want to see all these places. So it is very intensive, but we do think you're going to really enjoy the collection of places that we've selected for you all to visit.
Yeah, they're really amazing places. You're coming to one of the better part or the best parts of the U.S., although there's many places to see. As far as communication, you guys will have internet connection in most of your hotels. We will let you know for Yellowstone what to expect, as those hotels may not have internet connection, but most of your hotels will. During the first class days, there will be internet, but we kindly ask you to refrain from using your phone for personal reasons during class. You may step out if you need to communicate with loved ones, but the time to really do any personal communication is either in the morning before class or in the evening after class. Let's see. And we will be creating a WhatsApp group 2 days before everyone travels, or 2 days before the start of the seminar. And that will be our main method of communication throughout the seminar. If you guys go somewhere, we want to send a reminder regarding a meeting or class the next day, we will be communicating through the WhatsApp group. So I will be creating that, and you'll receiving a message from me in shortly. As far as hotels are concerned, you will be sharing a hotel room with another colleague of the same gender. We have arranged hotel roommates based on language, region, or age where possible. We try to put people with the same language if there's someone that speaks the same language. Just to give you a break, we know how hard it is to speak a second language all the time. We've all lived in foreign countries and speak multiple languages and know that that can be a very exhausting experience. So we try to give as many people that reprieve, but it's not always possible because we don't always have multiple people that speak the same primary language. And here we're just looking at a map of our route in Colorado. When you guys arrive at the airport, Denver Airport's actually not right in the city, it's just outside. And you can see Fort Collins to the north, about an hour and 10 minutes drive from the north of Denver. In your logistics letter, you received a list of what to pack. I highly recommend that you go through that list and make sure that you could bring what you can. There are items with asterisks, which means that we can provide those items or lend those items to you, such as wool gloves, wool hat, and sweaters. For those that are coming from warmer countries, it can get cool. 2 years ago, we had snow on the seminar for several days. Last year it was warmer, but average temperatures should be in the 20s during the day and could get as cold as 0 degrees Celsius in the evenings. So it can get pretty cold. If you do have a rain jacket, do bring that with you because we could receive precipitation. Just like Ryan mentioned, we will be meeting outside some of the times. And to be the most comfortable possible, it would be good to have those layers. Just a concept that we use here in Colorado and in this region of the country is that the weather is constantly changing. It's hard to predict whether it's gonna be warm or cold, sunny or rainy within one day, because it could be everything. It could go from very warm to cold, hail, rain, snow, all in the same day. So what we like to do is wear layers, and that just entails, you know, you have a shirt, but you also bring a sweater and a jacket so that you could put on layers as it gets colder and take off layers as it gets warmer. And hopefully that will help guide you when you think about clothes to bring so that you could put on different layers as the temperature and the climate changes throughout the day.
If any of you are thinking about or planning on trying to buy some outdoor gear or outdoor clothing, some of these things that Aaron's mentioning while you're here, things that you think you might also be able to use upon your return, there is a specific day in the seminar where we will be able to provide you with some guidance on where some of these stores are located and guide you to where they are. The key though is that the biggest city we're going to be in during the entire seminar is Fort Collins. So the first few nights of the seminar, where we are based in at the university, will be your best time to buy anything that you need for the seminar or for beyond. Some people sometimes come and want to buy a camera or a computer or something else like that. If you are looking to buy something, just as a heads up, please plan your time accordingly so that you can make those purchases while you're in Fort Collins. Once we leave Fort Collins, we won't be in cities of any size until we get to our last location, which is Jackson Hole, Wyoming, which has a few additional stores, but nothing like Fort Collins, and tends to also be much more expensive than Fort Collins. So just to keep that in mind for those that are planning on buying, whether that's gear, outdoor clothing, or other kinds of items while you're in the United States.
And if you don't have hiking boots, bringing comfortable shoes to walk in will be important. We will be going on some hikes, and we will be on our feet a lot walking around. So definitely think about comfortable footwear and something that's durable. Formal dress isn't necessary. We are a very informal or casual country, and wearing a t-shirt and pants is fine throughout the whole seminar. But if you do want to bring a formal dress or uniform or something that represents the traditional dress of your country, there will be two opportunities in which you could wear your formal dress, and that is one, a welcome reception that we'll have at the beginning of the seminar, where we'll invite some members of the community, the conservation and tourism community of Fort Collins, to meet and greet the group. And then at the end, the closing ceremony, where you can also dress up. But once again, it's not required. And then, of course, bring all of your personal toiletries and medications that you'll need for the entire seminar. Here in the U.S., you cannot ask for prescription medications without a physical prescription from a U.S. doctor. So if you run out of a medication that you normally take on a daily basis in your country here, it'll be very difficult to get it. You'll need to make a doctor's appointment, go to the doctor, ask for the prescription, pay for that doctor's appointment, and then go to the pharmacy. And we'll be in remote areas where, yes, there are hospitals and clinics where if there's an emergency, we'll be able to, you know, get you medical assistance. But meeting a doctor for personal medications will be very difficult. So please bring all medications that you will need during the entirety of the course. And just to remind you, we will have one van for luggage, but space is very limited. So you do not need to bring all the clothes that you will need for the 17 days. Most of the hotels do have laundromats, places where you can wash your clothes. We will be providing laundry soap. So you won't even have to buy laundry soap, and you will have an opportunity to wash your clothes throughout the course. We highly recommend that you just bring one big luggage and then a personal like backpack or computer case or something for day-to-day use. We don't have room to accommodate more than one big luggage in the luggage van with 28 participants. And next we're going to talk about airline baggage restrictions and customs and just going through immigration in the U.S. Essentially, for the airlines, you really need to go online and check your particular airline and your particular route and make sure you know their restrictions, because it can be very expensive to have an oversized or overweight piece of luggage. This is just an example for American Airlines, but I know you guys are coming on many different carriers internationally and U.S.-based carriers. So please go online before you go to the airport and check their particular restrictions. They're changing all the time, and we don't want you to arrive at the airport and find that you have to pay extra for your luggage. And as far as arriving at immigrations, you guys will have your visa, obviously. For those that have a J-1 visa, you should bring your DS-2019 with you, and you will need that for the entirety of the trip. And it doesn't hurt to bring your acceptance letter if you want, and the course brochure, which you could find on our website. Those are just additional supporting documents. If someone asks you about your stay in the U.S. and immigrations, at least you could present that. But you shouldn't have any trouble. We haven't had anybody have any difficulties in immigration. Sometimes we apologize. Sometimes people maybe aren't as welcoming as we would hope. The immigration officials sometimes are very nice, and sometimes may not be having the best day. But we will be here in Colorado waiting you to give you a hug and welcome you to the U.S. and to the seminar. This is just a map of Denver International Airport. And as you can see, there's different terminals. Depending on your airline, you'll arrive in Terminal A, B, or C. If you arrive in B and C, you will need to get onto the train. There will be signs in English directing you to where you need to go. And essentially, you'll just follow the crowd because everyone will be going to baggage claim. And you will take the train to baggage claim to the terminal, the main terminal of the airport, and look for your baggage claim. Usually a flight attendant will let you know where your baggage claim is for your flight. Or otherwise, you could look at the information boards, which will tell you your flight and which baggage claim number you will need to get your luggage from. Once you have your luggage, you're going to go to Terminal West. So the main terminal has an east side and a west side. It's all connected. There is a lot of construction, so it may seem a little confusing, but it is all connected, and you will be able to find your way through. And ultimately, you'll need to be with your luggage in Terminal West at baggage claim, near baggage claim number 17, near door 506. And if you can't find this place, there's a lot of attendants in the airport with cowboy hats on that are there to ask questions, any question of travelers. So you could just find someone with a cowboy hat and ask them, where is baggage claim number 17? And they will direct you in that way. We will be sending, as part of one of my final logistical communications, a arrivals document, which will organize everyone in arrival groups. So you will know which member of our team will be coming to meet you at the airport. We will have a name tag and a sign that says Colorado State University Tourism Seminar. And we will be waiting for you at baggage claim number 17. And so each arrival group will have a pickup time, and we won't leave until we have everybody. If for some reason your flight is delayed or you're having troubles or difficulties in your travels, just send us a WhatsApp message or a Facebook message or call us on a phone, and we will adjust the schedule based on your modified arrival time. But we've never had anyone not arrive, so you will get there. I know it's stressful to go to a new country for those of you that haven't arrived in the U.S. before, but everyone makes it, and we'll be there to greet you, give you some water, and we'll be getting in the vans, which it takes about an hour and 10 minutes, an hour and a half to get to Fort Collins.
So just to repeat, the baggage claim number 17 is not the area where everybody's luggage comes off. Your luggage could come off of any of the baggage claim areas. You'll have to find that baggage claim number depending on your airline and your flight, either from the flight attendant or from the boards. But then once you've claimed your bags from your own baggage claim, then we'll meet with your groups at baggage claim number 17, because our vans are parked right outside the door from baggage claim 17. If you happen to be flying in on American Airlines, baggage claim 17 actually also happens to be the baggage claim area for American Airlines. So anyways, just to clarify that point.
And also to mention, if you arrive in Terminal A, which I believe is American, you can take the train as well, but there's a pedestrian bridge and you're also able to walk to the main terminal where baggage claim is. But either way, you'll arrive in baggage claim. Just some additional considerations. We will be purchasing traveler's health insurance for every participant. This is an emergency health insurance. It really helps to reduce costs when there is an emergency and you need to go to the clinic. We want everyone to feel comfortable and healthy during the seminar, so any minor thing, just let us know. That we're in a climate that's very dry, we're at altitude, so there are some common conditions such as headaches or sometimes bloody noses that happen especially for people that come from countries where they're not used to altitude or to dry climates. But if you do need to go to the clinic, we are happy to bring you to the clinic. You will be receiving a medical card or a insurance card that essentially covers up to $100,000. It has a $100 deductible and does have a copay, which means that you are responsible for a little cost when you go to the doctor. This isn't for day-to-day checkups, so our system is maybe different from your country. It's very expensive to go to the doctor here. This isn't the time to go get everything checked and make sure everything is good. But if you do have a medical need, we will be able to take you and with your health insurance get you medical attention. As far as food is concerned, we invite you to try the American cuisine. The most variety of food that you will find is in Fort Collins, the best variety of food.
McDonald's every day, three times a day.
No, Ryan.
Just kidding.
He's just kidding. So in Fort Collins, you could find different foods from around the world. Maybe not all the foods from around the world, but we do have a good variety. But once we get on the road, we're going to be going to a more remote area of the U.S. Where people aren't accustomed to eating a variety of food, nor is there an offering of a variety of food. But also to remind you that while we have programmed meals throughout the course, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, based on just the logistics and the best timing for those meals, we do realize that some people, either get hungry midday or get hungry in between meals. And so we encourage you to on the stops, buy snacks and think about your needs in between meals, because there will be times when we're driving and we'll be in remote places and we won't have access to a place to stop for food. And if it's in between a meal, then it's your responsibility to really take care of those needs. Is there anything else?
You'll also be receiving a cash stipend that comes out of the money that's been paid for your program fee. That cash stipend is approximately $275, and that will go to help you pay for meals where you will be buying meals on your own. So many of the days you'll have meals that are included that we're already paying for them because it just makes more sense. It's easier or it's quicker for us to pay. But there's also sometimes where we have opportunities to allow you just to go out and get dinner on your own, experience whatever restaurant you'd like, and that's what the cash stipend is for, is to pay for those meals. And when you get the agenda, you'll notice on the agenda that after each meal, it will either have the word included or it will have a dollar symbol. If it has the word included on it, it means that it's already included in what's been paid for the seminar and you don't have to worry about having money for that meal. If you see a dollar symbol next to the meal, that means you need to use your stipend to pay for that meal.
And this stipend is enough for the whole entire course. If you select restaurants and plates that aren't luxurious every time. We've had participants run out of money, but that's because they've bought bottles of wine every night at expensive restaurants and gotten the most expensive plates. So you really have to budget and, you know, think about the amount of meals that you'll need to pay for and make that money last. But it is enough to get a good meal. It's just, it's not for the five-star restaurant dining experience every day.
Only McDonald's.
No, right.
Just kidding.
Pizza Hut, too. And then I know coming from different countries, you might be wondering, well, how do I charge my electronic devices? And so here's an image of the types of outlets and plugs that we have. We do operate off of 120 volts. Most devices such as computers and cell phones can charge on 120 or 220, so that's usually not an issue, but you will need to bring or buy an adapter. You could buy an adapter here in the U.S., but if you're coming from your country, you want to be sure that you have an adapter, it'd be best to buy one from where you're coming from. And participants will be responsible for having their own adapters to charge their own gear. Just some last minute logistics, and I want to thank everybody for being super responsive, for sending me their documents, visas, passports, etc. We still have some outstanding items, so I just want to reach out to everybody, and if I mention any names, I apologize if I mispronounce them. I'm looking forward to learning how to properly pronounce everybody's names. But we have a few visas outstanding. Nikes, you had an interview on August 22nd. I know you sent me an email. It wasn't clear if you were approved. So just give me an update. And I know, Paulus, you have an interview. So once you get your visa, we'll send it that way. There's still some this is in Spanish. Some diagnostic documents that are outstanding, and this really helps us finalize our preparation for your arrival. So I really need that information from your diagnostic today, hopefully, or as soon as possible. Victor, Alejandro, Nikes, Georgie, Gerard, Olga, and Huyen. And I apologize for the Spanish. We just had a Spanish language course and I copied these slides and, well, I forgot to change the language. And as far as flights are concerned, with my previous email, I had requested flight itineraries by last Friday. I understand that working with your donors, some of the purchases are a little delayed. But just a reminder, Victor, Alejandra, Nikes, Paulus, Tutia, I need your itineraries, and this is to help arrange airport pickup. So the sooner we have that, the sooner we could send out your information before you travel so that you know which pickup group you will be in. And then as far as those that we're helping arrange the purchase of flights, Svetlana, Thomas, Tadala, Sarinabal, Kinyan, Olga, and Batior, we are finalizing those purchases. And so I have your itineraries almost finalized. We're working with the university travel agency. They take quite a while, and I checked in with the travel agent, and she assured me that she's finalizing those purchases, so I'll be sending you your itineraries very shortly. Other people that aren't on this list have received their itineraries Friday or over the weekend. And then just for communication, while Facebook isn't necessary, if you don't have Facebook, don't worry. But we do try to provide different avenues that you can stay in touch with your colleagues and that we can stay in touch with you. And so I was looking for Facebook profiles and couldn't find quite a few. If you're seeing your name on your list and on this list and you have a Facebook profile, please send me the link to your Facebook profile. Oftentimes with some names, there's various different people and the pictures aren't always as clear, so I'm not sure who is the real you. So if you send me your link, that'll make it easier. And as far as WhatsApp, if you do have WhatsApp, please confirm and send your number, Gerard, Ginying, Olga, and Huyen. We don't have your WhatsApp numbers, and that will make communication much easier. We do rely on WhatsApp as a communication method for the seminar.
And so, and for the Facebook side of things, just to let you know, like Aaron said, it's not necessary. I know lots of people in the world don't participate in Facebook specifically because they don't want to be part of that network. But if you happen to be on the network, we do share lots of good information, different training opportunities, scholarship opportunities. There's lots of opportunities to share information, not only with people that are going to be on the seminar this year, but with people that have been on seminars in past years. So the Facebook community just tends to be a place for continued professional discussion and exchange well beyond the 17 days that we'll be together this year.
And you will be receiving one last logistics email from me, and that will have the airport arrival document, which will show your pickup group and pickup time, and we'll have a picture of each of us so you know who to look for, the finalized agenda, a participant profile document so that you can start to get to know your colleagues even before arriving in Colorado. When you're on the plane, you can read that and get to know who you will be sharing this experience with. And then there's a Colorado State University waiver. I will be sending that to you just to read and look over. You do not need to sign it and send it back to me at this moment. But on the first day of the seminar, you will have to sign that waiver in order to participate in the seminar. That's a requirement, a legal requirement based by the university. And so it is not optional, and you will have to sign the waiver in order to continue on with the seminar. And that's the reason why we send it to you ahead of time, so there are no surprises with the content of the waiver.
That participant profile document, that's the document that Jim Barbarak was referring to that we send out to the different colleagues that we're going to be meeting with. The diagnostic form actually has a lot more specific and detailed information that we use as a team of instructors to help think about the best way to run the seminar, and gives us more detailed information about each and every one of you. However, the information that we share more publicly with our contacts so that they know who they're meeting with is the profile document.
Just have a picture of one of our past years. Which year was this, Ryan?
This was about 3 years ago.
And you can see they're pretty happy. We do a chuck wagon dinner, which is a unique touristic experience within the Black Hills National Forest. So we'll be looking forward to that. And we are going to look through the chat group right now and look for the questions that you've sent throughout and make sure we've responded to all those questions. But if there's a new question that arrives to your mind, just write it in the chat book.
I'll go ahead and respond to the first question here from Sebastian Sierra from Ecuador. There are opportunities for buying things on Amazon. It's a little difficult with this particular seminar because it's a mobile seminar where we're constantly moving. I would not recommend buying something on Amazon and having it shipped to the hotel at the last night where we're going to be staying, just because the hotels have constant turnover of people that are staying there, and I just would fear that something might be lost. I think if there are people that are going back to Denver or back to Fort Collins and staying a few days after the trip, there could be a possibility of ordering things through Amazon and having it delivered, like, for example, to my personal home. And then once we got back to Fort Collins on the 22nd of September, either that evening or the next morning, I could bring those packages over to the hotel where you happen to be staying. So there is a way that we could work out an option for you to buy things through Amazon. If someone is particularly interested in buying something from Amazon and want to buy it before the seminar, I can, you just, if you want to email me, I can provide you with my address now, and you could have it ordered and shipped to my house before you leave for the seminar, in the hopes that it would arrive before we leave Fort Collins. That would be another option. Mm-hmm. So if either one of those options sounds like it may work, you feel free to reach out to me directly to my email address, and we can make some arrangements.
And just to mention, if you absolutely need something sent, please ask us to verify the mailing addresses for these hotels, like if that's an absolute urgent thing, because oftentimes the street address is not the mailing address for the hotels, and the hotels in Jackson on the last nights, it's pretty complicated. It's very difficult to get packages there, so that's just really not a good place to send a package to. We're looking at additional questions. There was a question of how many participants will there be in the group, and Ryan responded with 28 participants from 19 countries. We have a very diverse group.
There was also a question just about the class hours that Jim did respond to. The class hours tend to be fairly intensive. We start in the morning after breakfast, and we usually go into the late afternoon or early evening. That will vary from day to day. Some days we have long drives that actually continue on into the evening. There's other days where we try to end a little earlier. Some days where we have more classroom time, others were primarily in the field. So the days will be varied throughout the seminar, but we hope that we have left enough time for everyone to get enough sleep and stay rested enough to be able to take the good advantage of all the places we'll be visiting in the seminar.
And I see a question regarding those returning to Denver from Sebastian. Will you be staying overnight at the university, or you have to find a hotel for the last night? So that last night, for those that are returning to Denver with our team after the end of the seminar, that last night is not covered by the course, and it is the responsibility of the participants to book a hotel room. During the first days of the seminar, I will be identifying those people that will be returning to Colorado or to Fort Collins with us, and we can get a university rate with the hotel that you'll be originally staying at, and sharing that room with another colleague of the same gender comes out to around $45, and I could help make those reservations if you choose to stay there. There's also some hostels that come out in the $30, $35 range. But those coming back to Colorado after the end of the seminar will have to book a room for an additional night before catching their flights the next day if you are leaving out of Denver on the 23rd.
Me. If there are any other questions, please feel free to include them in the box, in the chat box. Otherwise, we're happy to continue to respond to any questions that you may have as you start preparing for your departure by email and over the next coming days. We know there's a lot of things to get ready for as you prepare to depart your home, as you prepare to depart your work, and as you prepare to depart your family, to be gone for 17 plus days. Please take your time to prepare everything these next few weeks, so that you can fully be engaged in the seminar once you arrive. There is one question about a laptop. There is no laptop requirement. It's not necessary to bring a laptop. You won't need it for any specific things. When you're giving your presentations, you're welcome to use one of our laptops to make your presentation. However, some people find it nice to have a laptop in the evening if they want to do email or stay in communication with people. But having a laptop is not necessary. In terms of Sebastian's question about formal meetings, none of our meetings throughout the seminar are necessarily formal. They're all casual or informal. However, there are two opportunities where if you wish to dress more more formally. That would be at the beginning reception that takes place on the first Friday evening that you're here, and then the farewell dinner that takes place in Jackson Hole the night before either you fly out of Jackson Hole or the night before we return the drive to Fort Collins. And so and even then it doesn't have to be formal. It just maybe if you wanted to dress a little nicer, we have everyone dressing up with a nice fancy pants and shirt and tie to people wearing pants and a t-shirt on those evenings. So it really is any attire will be appropriate. Just sometimes people like to, especially if you come from a country that has more traditional clothing, it's nice on those more formal events to be able to wear and share your traditional attire with the group.
Any additional questions, last minute questions? Well, we really thank you for being here. We're really excited to meet everybody. This is gonna be a great seminar, and just wish you the best in your preparations. We'll be seeing you very soon.
Yes, good luck with all the final preparations. Don't forget to kiss and hug all your loved ones and family, and come prepared for a great adventure. We look forward to sharing this part of the Western United States with you over the 17 days of the seminar in September. And we look forward to seeing you very soon. So safe travels, everyone.
And welcome to Colorado in just over a week.